experience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Hey, everybody, it's the LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Hung out with Drew last night.
Yeah.
Got our swerve on. Did a little partying. We don't get out too much.
Oh.
I had a good time.
Yeah.
Tilted a few with Dr. Drew. You got your buzz going, right?
Yeah, I wasn't feeling very well, so I was just telling you about that. I wasn't feeling too hot.
Drew's got a hernia happening.
Yes. You had one too for a while, right?
No, not that long, like 9.5 years.
Mine's just bugging the hell out. I've got to get it repaired.
What are you going to do? What's that entail?
A laparoscopic procedure.
Laparoscopic?
Yeah, endoscope.
Where do they go in?
Just right there.
In your hip?
Yeah.
They don't go up anything or?
No, they don't go up your keister or anything.
You know, that whole.
That's outside your body. I've told you that a million times.
Yeah. Yeah, tell that to my toilet.
Mm-hmm.
That whole thing where people go, oh, no, medical technology has come to a point where we don't have to make a small 2-millimeter incision in the fleshy part of your hip. We'll feed this snake up your urethra. And my thing is like, go ahead and make the incision.
That's right.
Like, here's your choice. You got, here are your outlet choices. You got nasal, you got mouth, you got urethra, and you got anus. My feeling is make the cut.
Yeah.
Instead of sliding something up my nose that's going to end up around my ass or pushing something down the urethra, just go ahead and make that incision.
I know it seems easier, but it's things that are outside your body don't get infected.
Yeah.
So if you remain out your nose, your mouth, your esophagus, your rectum, that's all outside your body.
Right.
You can't get infected if you put things into that. Well, as soon as you open the skin and get inside the tissue, now you introduce infection and bleeding, all this stuff.
Is your bowel outside of your body?
The inside, the lumen of your bowel is outside your body.
Yeah, see, I still can't understand this outside versus inside.
Yeah.
What about your lungs?
Inside.
Inside, but your throat is outside the body?
Yes, yeah.
Why do they say the body, though? It's confusing.
It is confusing. Maybe, what should we say, the tissue?
No, that's boring.
Right.
Rather be confused.
Well, I would only come up with that, yes.
Erin?
Hello?
You're 21?
Yes.
What's up?
Okay, I have somewhat of a complicated problem.
Mm-hmm.
I moved from D.C. to L.A. about 2 years ago. I just, picked up, packed my suitcases, and just moved out here. I had, a couple of bad experiences there, and...
In college or something? What?
Yeah, I was in college, and I guess I just met the wrong people.
All right, so what's happening now?
So now I just broke up with my boyfriend, who I was dating out here for about a year and a half.
Mm-hmm.
And I still really love him. I care about him a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that, I'm pretty crazy, and there's no way that he's ever going to get back together with me.
Crazy? What does that mean?
Well, I have serious problems with attachment and commitment and...
Well, so he broke up with you?
Pretty much. I mean, eventually it just got to the point where he had to, tell me,
It got too crazy.
She broke up with him at the beginning.
Yeah.
All right, so he dumped you.
So, yeah, he dumped me. And, now I'm trying to, get back into the swing of things and, reestablish being single, and I have no clue what I'm doing.
Quiet down. Everyone gets into this. I was married for 13 years.
Yeah.
Now I'm single. I don't know how to be single. Here's how you be single. You sit home and beat off and watch TV and eat.
I know, that's so lonely.
Well,
do you have friends?
Yeah, but when you've mastered it, it's not so bad.
But I've only been out here for 2 years, and I only know a couple of people.
What do you do for a living?
What's that?
How do you support yourself?
My parents help me out, and I have a job.
Doing what?
I work for a nonprofit organization.
And you meet no one through that?
I've met a couple of people.
Maybe you need a new job where you meet more people, that sort of thing.
I've met mostly females. And
screw the impoverished. You're right, Drew.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying she needs to take care of herself a little bit. She's not going to be much good to that organization if she's miserable.
Do you have, are you one of these women that doesn't like other women?
I'm not. But, I guess I've just gotten to a point where it's I was really promiscuous for a while, and I've kind of, through my last relationship, realized that it's like a lot better when you know the person and you trust the person.
Yeah.
Whatever. And
so all right.
So now that I'm back out, it's like everybody just kind of makes me sick. I can't meet people, and I don't know how.
All right. Well, okay. Hold on a second. You know, we have people telling us that they want to meet people, they want to be part of a group, they want more friends, but then they tell us everyone makes them sick.
Right. They hate people. They can't.
Yeah. So maybe it's not time. I mean, I'm just doing the math here. But yeah. if you can't handle people, they make you sick, then maybe you should be staying in.
Yeah.
Or getting a little treatment.
Or getting a little treatment. How about a little therapy?
I've been in and out of therapy for like 8 years.
Yeah.
And I never get anywhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, you're not trying.
I am trying.
What's the diagnosis you've been given? Borderline personality.
Yeah, suspected bipolar disorder. Okay, suspected borderline personality disorder.
All right. Now, should she be on some medications?
Yeah.
I am on medication.
Okay. Who's prescribing that?
My psychiatrist.
All right. And but they're not recommending a therapy?
No, they are recommending therapy. And I go on and off, but
stick with it. That's your whole attachment problem. But, I mean, she's describing a borderline history. That's,
all right.
And the bipolarity was improved with the meds. And borderlines are better on serotonin reuptake inhibiting drugs, too. So.
But I don't know what advice we can give her other than do what your psychiatrist tells you to do, get some therapy,
yeah.
And relax a little, make some friends.
Borderlines go through these cycles of high, you know, like social activity and then isolation. And sometimes she could, if she really wants to get involved in some, it's just that sometimes there are organizations that treat people that go through the cycles of high levels of sexual activity and then go through periods of deprivation. And the using deprivation as an arousal mechanism is its own kind of needs its own kind of treatment.
All right. That meant nothing. Yeah. Melissa?
Yeah.
You're 15?
Yeah.
What's the matter, baby doll?
Well, the reason I'm calling you is because I found out not a few days ago, I think on Friday night, today's Sunday, that the lady I'm living with, who I always thought was my mom, was not my mother, she was my aunt.
Hmm.
And she was very, very mean to me.
Your whole life?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was told when I was 3.
She what?
I moved to her when I was 3.
Well, how is it you didn't know it was your...
Because it happened, on Friday night my uncle called me.
Wait.
How did you know at age 3? Didn't you know it wasn't your mom who you're moving into?
No, I don't remember it at all.
Wait, you said you moved in with her when you were 3?
Yeah.
How did you know that?
Because on Friday night, my uncle called me, and I never speak to him at all. But he had gotten really big fight with my aunt that week, and he was just paying her back. And he goes to me, you know, that whoever's not your mom, and I go, I don't know what you're saying. And he goes, your mom is a heroin addict. She died when you were 6, though.
When you were 6?
Yeah, he just said she died, then I don't know why she died. He didn't tell me. It's just that.
Well, heroin addicts die. I mean, that's what happens.
What?
All right, so where's the uncle?
I don't. He's kind of jerky. I don't see him much.
He's not married to the aunt you're living with.
No. He's, I guess, my aunt's brother.
Okay, it's a different uncle.
Different uncle.
No, I mean, I see him like, you know, Christmas, and I didn't.
Right. Our listeners and callers never sweat the details.
No.
I'm sorry.
I know. Well, you said you're living with your aunt. Your uncle called you, so
I'm really sorry to confuse.
That's all right.
I'm sorry.
All right. Don't worry. Don't be sorry.
Did you love your aunt?
No.
You never loved her.
Well, I thought she was my mom, but she was very, she used to tell me I was ugly, and then she had two of her boyfriends, none of them were particularly nice, but only two of them really bothered me a lot.
In what way?
Well, one of her boyfriends was a serious boyfriend for like 4 years.
Yeah.
And he was supposed to pick me up from daycare, as I was at, the daycare could end at 6 o'clock. And on the way home, he would stop his car in the parking lot. And he told me I was supposed to touch him and stuff, and he would touch me.
Okay, have you ever had any treatment for all this?
No, because I didn't have anyone to talk to.
Okay.
All right,
now you hear this show. People go through these kinds of traumas all the time.
I don't want to be like the people on the show. I don't want to be like my family.
You don't want to be like the people on this show?
I'm sorry, but I am, and I'm very embarrassed.
Embarrassed.
I understand. That's normal to feel embarrassed and ashamed, but you were a victim. This wasn't something that you had any hand in.
Because when I was little, I remember once when I was 7, he molested me from like 5 to 9.
Mm-hmm.
I remember told my aunt she left her.
Mm-hmm.
and I was at this girl's house. Mm-hmm. When I, you know, we used to, like, talk about boys and stuff a little bit, and mm-hmm. she was always like, oh, you know, I think Wawa likes me, and I would always brag that, you know, why I get to...
All right, hold on a second, Melissa, because we got to cut our losses here and figure out a plan for you. And I don't mean to cut off your tragic tale, but I'm sure you have many of them.
Let me just say that being aroused by or proud of or into the experience is often what makes the victims feel most wicked. But realize none of it has anything to do with you. It was all perpetrated upon you. You're just reacting the way kids react when something bad happens.
All right, just listen, Melissa, because we just have a very limited amount of time.
I'm sorry.
All right, no, that's all right. Listen, you're 15. You've been to hell and back.
I'm actually 14, but I was afraid that she would think that's too ridiculous.
All right, you're 14. You've been to hell and back.
No.
And you're still alive. You're still in one piece.
But I don't want...
No, just listen to me.
Sorry.
You found out some tragic news. Life's going to be difficult. It doesn't mean it's going to be bad or over.
The news doesn't change anything.
It doesn't change anything.
No, it's not that. It's just that I used to think that I should live with her and take care of her because she was my mom.
Well, thank God.
I'm going to her, but I don't want to be with her.
Thank God you've come to that realization, because there is the person that really, although thankfully she took you in, she's an awful person and brought these horrible abusers around.
I don't even know what to do.
Yeah, but thank
Melissa.
God you don't feel responsible for her, so you can begin to take care of yourself.
Okay, so what's our advice? She's 14. She's living in Bakersfield. That's the real tragedy.
She needs to finish that off. But call.
We just played Bakersfield.
I'm going to give you a phone number, and I hope she will call the number. It's 1-800. Give you two numbers, 540-4000.
I'll just give her the best one twice.
Well, there's two, 1-800-540-4000 and 1-800-422-4453, 422-4453. And call them and talk it out and call Department of Social Services and really start getting support for you. And
yeah, I don't know, but we don't know if she's being abused or anything right now.
There's no statute on these things, you know what I mean?
Oh, okay. Yeah, so call those numbers, but just lose yourself in schoolwork or Christianity or something. Just to try to stay out of the house. And that doesn't mean running with a-holes either.
She wants the number again. It's 1-800. Have her stay on hold. I'll talk to her off the air.
Yeah, all right. Don't give it again. Melissa.
Can I ask you a question?
No. Listen, Drew's going to talk to you off the air. He's going to give you those numbers, all right?
Question.
No, get a pad and pencil.
I promise I will.
All right, what's your question?
I used to try not to date and stuff, and then when I went to like a little spring dance.
Try not to what?
Date. Spring date? Dance.
I did, and so I went to a school dance with an older boy, mm-hmm. and in the car he started like.
Okay, let me deal with this on.
All right.
I will deal with that.
Listen, it's tough to cut off people that are in such bad shape, but. I think we're just going to get another long story of molestation. Drew's got to step in and mop up during the break. Claire?
Yep.
You're 28?
Yep. I've been going to college for 10 years full-time since I got out of high school.
Yeah.
And I'm starting to feel that there's no real point to it.
Well, 10 years in college, I wonder what the point is.
Yeah, so you're supposed to go for 4 years, and then you enter the workforce.
Or graduate school.
Well, a few family crises left me in community college for a long time.
What could be so bad that you would end up in community college?
My father died, then my grandma died, my mom had a bunch of surgery on her back.
So you were forced to go to junior college?
Well, I kept going to junior college in order not to quit going to school.
Uh-huh. I see.
And I finally moved up to the big school last year, and I'm just not...
So you were junior... Wait. Junior college for 9 years?
Oh, that's nothing.
Yeah.
That's a light sentence.
Yeah, but that's not...
You walk around, you go over to Valley College, average sentence is 13 to 17 years.
Be that as it may, these medical problems didn't, require a 9-year span.
True, you know what
so
it's
this,
like.
The point is more going on here.
All right, but listen, Claire.
Yeah.
Maybe college isn't your best place. That's not where you shine. It seems like you've had long enough to see if this was a good fit for you, and maybe it's not. So how about finding a job?
I have a job.
All right.
But the problem is what I want to do in life, I can't do without any degree, and I don't even have a bachelor's yet.
What do you want to do? Motivational speaking?
Forensic pathology.
Forensic pathology. Did we speak to you some years back?
No. This is the first time I've ever called.
That woman had a different voice. I remember that call.
Somebody called about wanting to get involved with forensic pathology. And how close are you to a degree in that? Or do you have to be a doctor to be a forensic pathologist?
Yeah, I have to go through medical school and then graduate school.
All right. Well, I've done some quick math on that. See, 8.5 years. Let me do what? Let me do the junior college math here. Yeah. 8.5 years in junior college, then need to go to medical school. It's going to be 2072 mm-hmm. When you actually walk with that degree. So, well, wait a minute. Where is she?
Four.
Oh, line four. But wait a minute. How can she be? Oh, there it is. I'm sorry. So, Claire.
Yeah.
Forget about it. Listen, let me just tell you this. Everybody, and I've known many people that do this, and Drew, it's your kind that perpetuate these myths.
How's that?
As long as you're in college, you're doing something honorable. And as long as you're moving toward a goal, well, quiet down, especially something that's, you know, doctor, forensic, whatever, engineer, something. As long as you're moving toward that goal, no matter what the pace is, it's honorable in a sense. Now, Drew, you're going to roll your eyes if you hear about someone spending 10 years in junior college, but we support this in general as a society. And I've had friends that have done this. They're 33. I had a friend of mine who announced he was going to be a doctor after about his 18th year of junior college, and everyone was sort of applauding. Well, that's great. That's fantastic. And I told him, are you high? Get to work. Stop. This is nothing more than you buying time.
Well, I actually am a little insulted by that. The fact that people think that they just, once they decide to do it, that's it.
Yes.
You know, you have to do it. You have to compete. You have to get better grades than everybody every year from the beginning.
Or your dad has to pay off the dean, like Drew.
That's right.
That's right.
And then maybe you get in somewhere. But to think that you'll have to just do it and then it'll happen, that's not realistic.
Claire, if you were going to make your move, you would have made that already. So I'm saying,
I was doing well in junior college, but when I moved up to the big school, my grades started falling off because.
All right, because you had to read and write and stuff like that.
No, because I had to keep up with 22-year-olds who could stay up all night and cram, and I can't do that. I'm at work right now.
Yeah, yeah. Listen, I would have been a much better student at 28 than I was at 19 or 20. You're keeping up with guys that are doing beer bongs all night, not staying up and cramming. You got a lot of excuses, Claire. You need to just find a decent job. Hey, if it's a couple of years, like you want to be a nurse and there's some program or something like that, and it's going to take a couple of years, by all means.
Well,
but a forensic pathologist ain't going to work.
We shouldn't deflate people's.
Yes, we should.
No, you should keep be realistic and assess your strength and do what you're good at and you like and that kind of thing. But don't assume.
Now get to work. That's what you need to do, Drew.
All right.
That's anyone who's been in junior college. That's you know what I'm going to do when I'm in charge, Drew?
You have a limit?
I'm going to tag people.
Yeah.
It's going to be like Logan's.
Caribou.
Hey, yeah, I'm going to treat junior college like Logan's Run. Everyone who turns 30 and is still on campus, out.
Then they're not allowed to go anywhere else.
You get put in that circle where you float around and we disintegrate you.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, just like Logan's Run. It's going to be great, Drew. It'll be a utopia we're living in. I don't mean to sound like a huge prick. But
no, not at all. You sound right.
Who's Claire kidding herself? Come on. She's 28. She's still in college.
Well, the thing is, the plan that she has is minimum 10 years more.
Right.
That's if she excels every step of
those
the way.
Those are Claire years.
Those are excelling every year, not missing a
yes.
beat. 10
Claire
years.
Years, they're 70 years.
It could be.
Forget it. Get to work. Jeremy?
Yes.
You're 23?
I'm 23.
Let me say this, too. All the successful people I know, with the exception of Dr. Drew, did not go to college. They went to college for a little while. It didn't quite work out. They wasn't the right fit, and they ended up interning somewhere and then working their way up the ladder. That's
I
it.
Complete college.
You did or didn't?
Did not.
Did not. And look at you now. You're a big success.
Yeah, I just opened up a company actually last year.
That's right.
Bongs are us.
That's right. Well, he actually provides the bowls and drills the cars for the company that makes the bongs. He's not that high up yet. That's
right. What's up, Jeremy?
Got a little dilemma. I don't know. You guys are probably going to have a field day with this, but my roommate is he's pretty gay, and he doesn't want to really admit it. And,
well, your sense of him that he is, or he tells you he's gay and is afraid to tell anybody?
Well, he didn't really tell me. Like, when we first moved in, he didn't tell me. I actually found out through somebody. We were out at a club, and, like, she came up to me, and she's like, well, she's like, are you bisexual, too? I'm like, what are you talking about? She's like, well, your roommate just told me that he's bisexual. She's like, are you bisexual?
That might be some kind of ploy. In his
well, let's say the guy's gay.
Well, he is.
All right. All right. Man knows.
There's definitely ways we know, but, yeah, he is for sure. But the thing is, like,
did the ice cream truck just pull in? Well, that's what gay guys drive. They drive Miatas or ice cream trucks, Drew. You didn't know that?
I didn't know that.
That's fascinating. It's in the gay bylaws.
I'm glad you announced
gay laws.
3 minutes ago. You didn't want to sound like a colossal prick, but so keep going. Yes.
Jeremy. All right.
Well, the main reason Jeremy knows he's gay is no one could suck a dork like this kid if he was straight. Am I right, Jeremy?
I'm sorry, say that again.
No one uses the hand on the nuts. No one does that sort of circular motion with the tongue. And there's no way you get that sensation unless the guy's gay, right? That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go with you on that one.
All right. So, look, he's gay, so what?
What's the deal? So what's the problem?
No, like, he just, his social life is just completely, like the guy's 33 years old.
And he doesn't have any gay friends or what?
He doesn't have any friends whatsoever. I mean, this guy hangs on every move that I make.
So do you talk to him about what he's up to?
I've tried to. Right. I've really tried to. This has been going on for like 8-9 months.
Well, you think he's got the hots for you?
Yeah. He's right. Written me like letters
I'm
and
not
stuff.
Getting questioned.
Yeah, I'm not either. But listen, Jeremy, he's written you love letters?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is bogus.
But
no,
listen,
I've said stuff to him.
No, this is bogus. But look, Jeremy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, buddy.
A successful entrepreneur like yourself should be able to afford his own crib, right?
Yeah. I'm working on that.
All right. Well, that's what you need to work on.
Yeah.
That was bogus. Yeah. But here's the thing, too, everybody. I haven't given this speech in a while. Bad roommates are bad news.
We've not had roommate calls in a while, have we?
Bad roommates will give you crabs and get you killed. Mm. You will have...
Both happened to you.
Yes, I was given crabs in 1984, and I was killed dead in 87, I believe.
You were shot, but you're alive today.
Right, like our PSA goes. But look, bad roommates are just bad, and you think you can reason with them, you can't. And everyone gets caught up in the, well, I put the cleaning deposit down, so I'm... No. Cut your losses and get out of there.
I'd say that statement would apply to all failing relationships, whether it's business, romantic, roommate, whatever.
If you're under the age of 30,
you don't have kids,
I don't care what the relationship is. Yep. If it ain't working, cut your losses. Yep. Unless you're in the Army and you don't have a good relationship with your drill sergeant or something like that. Don't go AWOL. But bad roommates, get out.
Scumbag.
All right. We will take ourselves a little break. We'll be right back.
1-800-LOVE-191. As many as 1 in 3 Americans with HIV don't know it. To find a testing location near you, call toll-free 1-866-344-KNOW.
Hey everybody, LoveLine, I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. That's my song, everybody. Yeah. Dr. Drew just told me during the break all about hernias.
Nice.
And had an old patient had a big sack full of bowel.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Is that hernia?
That hernia is just bowel coming through the abdominal wall. That's what hernia is.
Will it fill up your sack?
It can, yeah.
Drew said he had an old patient about 4 foot of bowel. Mm-hmm. In his sack. I know you're exaggerating.
Well, I think how much, fill up a volleyball size.
Volleyball size sack.
Yeah.
Was it?
It's not perfectly round like that. It sort of hangs, you know.
Mm-hmm. Drew also said he had an old guy whose sack went down to his knee.
Almost.
Yeah. I don't know if I buy that either.
I'll bring in, show you some people if you like.
Well, just... Get some pictures, some measurements, some affidavits, and I'll take a look at that paperwork. All right?
Fair enough.
All right. Erica?
Yes.
You're 18. What's up?
Yes. I had a question. I've been with my boyfriend for a year, and we've been having sex for like about a year already. And I don't know why, like every time before like we're going to, like it's like really tight down there, and like it hurts. Like it like takes a while, like. For like it to go in, and like I was wondering, like I've been having sex this long, so like wouldn't I be used to it? Or I didn't know what was wrong. I didn't know if it was.
No, there's no sort of. You don't have to get used to it. And does it stop hurting after a little while?
Yeah.
All right. So some people it continues to be painful. So the fact that you are able to sort of loosen up and feel okay is a good thing. You may just be one of these people that, A, either the anatomy is smaller relative to your boyfriend, or you may have a lot of muscular contraction down there that might make it sort of uncomfortable when things get started.
How long does it take to loosen up?
Like about a minute or two.
All right, that's fine.
Yeah. That's fine.
All right, that's you, baby.
That's all right. I wanted to make sure nothing was wrong with that.
No, you should be getting pelvic exams, right?
Yes.
Have you had that done recently?
No, I'm due for another one. It was a year last time.
All right. Do they have any problem getting the speculum in when they do those exams?
No.
All right.
What are you using for birth control?
I'm on the pill.
The all pill.
Ortho tricyclic.
All right, baby.
Excellent.
Stay on that pill.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
No babies.
All right,
yeah.
No babies.
Thank you.
All right. Yeah. There. Bye-bye. That's a good
woman
there.
Yeah, we need like a fetus with a circle with a red bar through it.
Yeah.
Going diagonally. Yeah, it'd be good.
No babies. You just have some guy shoot you when you walk in front of an abortion clinic.
That's right.
Jason?
Yeah.
You're 16?
Yeah.
You got a 17-year-old girlfriend?
Yes, correct.
She's pregnant?
Mm-hmm.
And she's smoking pot?
Yes. And I think she's doing ecstasy, too.
Mm-hmm. Oh, good times. Well, we don't really know the full effects of ecstasy on a pregnancy, but I suspect it's not going to be good.
Oh, you think not good?
I think not good.
I don't know. I think superpowers.
Superpowers, could be.
Kid comes out.
Giant.
Being able to fly and deflect bullets with her wrist cuffs.
Could be. Still depressed, though.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Jason?
Yeah.
You still in high school?
Yeah.
And is she in high school, too?
Mm-hmm.
And is she a grade older than you?
No, I'm going to be 17 in 2 weeks. So.
You guys are in the same grade?
Yeah.
And
how far along is she?
3 months.
Three, 4 months.
You guys going to get married?
Maybe.
Okay, but she's going to...
We've been together for a while now, so...
All right. She's going to have the kid?
I told her that if she keeps doing ecstasy and stuff, I'm going to try to convince her to get an abortion, because I don't want to have, like, a...
It may be too late for that.
Maybe
past the point of no return on the pregnancy, but... Right. Yeah, she's abusing this child, and you need to report that so she can have help containing those behaviors.
Okay.
If they find out that she's done this, she could go to jail for child abuse, quite literally, in some states.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Hmm. And what about giving the kid up for adoption, Jason?
Which is really what you heroes should do.
All right. I
get the real sense. Either this is bogus or Jason has no sense that this is his child.
Well, he just doesn't care. I mean, you know, there's parenting and then there's parenting, you know? Yeah.
It's like it's out there. It's just something happening to somebody out there.
But Jason, you realize you may have a kid here in a few months, and then you're going to be responsible for this child. Yeah?
Yes, I do.
Except this is a bogus call.
All right. David, don't buy it.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's bogus tonight or just guys not caring. And here's the thing, too. Go ahead and make a bogus call. Turn off the goddamn set in the background and pay attention.
Yeah.
And let's really nail the cues on the bogus calls. Not sort of, these guys make bogus calls and then become uninterested in their own bogus call halfway into it. They start drifting off.
Yeah, whatever.
All right. I hope that's bogus, Michelle.
Well, even isn't. I mean, it's, pay attention. Think about adoption. Report her for the abuse.
Yes. Michelle?
Hello?
You're 16?
Mm-hmm.
What's up?
Okay, last year, when I was still 16, I was with a guy for a long time, and ended up getting pregnant, and I had a miscarriage. And ever since then, I've really wanted a baby, and
sure,
I know that people would say that's really stupid, and it is kind of stupid considering I'm 16.
Yeah.
But,
well, to have the desire is one thing, but to act on it is another. As Adam always says, behave as if you were smart and sane.
Yeah, that's all you got to do. You'll fool everybody. You'll fool the cops. You'll fool your teachers. You'll fool your parents and society.
We have all kinds of drives and all kinds of impulses as human beings. And eventually they just become so much background noise we really don't even believe we have them. But, we had to get potty trained at one time, and Adam still urinates on his buddies, convinced that it's sterile. He's sterilizing them.
Wow, guy does a little tinkle in the sink six times a day, and all of a sudden he's got a problem.
I understand. And... to have had a child and go from pregnant to not pregnant very often leaves women with a sense of intense loss and sort of a longing for that attachment again. And naturally enough, you would look towards a solution to that as filling back up again, having a baby again. And that's not a healthy or realistic impulse. It certainly is not good for a child.
All right.
Okay?
So, Michelle,
but it's okay that you have
plus
the impulse.
Plus, she sounds like she's 5, which is bad.
Michelle?
Yeah? You okay?
What'd you say?
You doing okay in school?
Oh, No.
School's that place with the mean old people in the books. Did you get molested? We should start gambling again, Drew.
All right.
Anything weird happen to you growing up?
First of all, I've had bipolar symptoms my whole life, and I've gone through a lot of trauma.
Neglect.
I was raped twice.
How old were you?
14. When I got raped?
Yeah.
15. 14,
or 15. Bat mitzvahs. 15?
Yeah, that's the parents get raped then.
All right. Hey,
By the same guy.
Same guy.
Mm-hmm.
Two times. Did you report him?
I'm in the process of reporting
him. Neglect. Where were your parents when you were little?
When I was little?
Yeah.
Where were they?
Yes.
They were away?
Where were they when you were little?
What do you mean, though?
It seems like they weren't around much.
When I was 3, my sister was born, so... Like, all of a sudden, I had this total mood change, and I felt, you know, all the tension was gone, and...
When you were 3, you remember that?
Yeah. I remember a lot from when I was 3 and up.
Okay. Okay, you remember what a pain in the ass you were when you were 3 and up?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, okay. Do you want one of those running around all day that you got to take care of when you don't have any money and you got some a-hole hanging out, boozing? Hitting people with his belt.
Okay. Where's my bourbon?
Listen, look. Let me just say something to the phone screeners on the radio program tonight. I have to speak to coherent people who can form sentences.
Can understand English.
Yeah,
it doesn't have to, even if English is the third language. I don't care. They understand better than some of our callers tonight.
Right. Everybody's profoundly effed up, and. I don't mind talking to effed up people, but if it's like just talking to an effed up farm animal, forget it.
Yeah.
Let's just take them out back.
Alma.
You know what I'm saying?
I mean,
why talk to someone that can't absorb any information whatsoever? Michelle, do not get pregnant. All right? I know that means nothing. That just sounds like Charlie Brown's teacher speaking to you, or what your dog must hear when you speak to it. Oh, maybe she doesn't know the dog doesn't understand, but do not have kids. I know you're going to crank a few out. God bless you. Anne?
Hi.
You're 23?
Yeah. I'm dating a guy who's been married for about 5 years, but he's been separated for a couple of years. His wife is in China. He's Chinese, and he's been staying married to her to try to help her get into the country. And I guess I feel like I'm...
How do you know they're separated?
She's in
China. How do I know they're separated?
No, because Chinese families do that a lot, where the guy lives away for a long time and prepares things and then moves the family over.
You know what makes the show...
It usually takes a concubine in the meantime.
You know what makes the show like 50% longer every night?
Yeah.
How do you know they're separated? How do I know they're separated? It's really... You know when you do interviews, Drew, they ask you to repeat the question?
Yes, that's for purposes of cutting.
Right, for editing.
And by the way, you're not supposed to repeat the question. You're supposed to, in the answer, say, I know they're separated because...
Right. Anne.
Yeah.
How do you know they're separated?
She's in China and he's in the U.S.
All right, yeah, I just yelled that at Drew. But it still doesn't mean that they're separated.
Yeah. I don't know if they're legally separated or not.
Yeah, sometimes I've got a lot of friends who are Chinese that their families will separate geographically while the man prepares a business and a home for the... wife and kids, and brings them over later.
True, you're hanging out with the Chinaman all
of
a sudden?
I have Chinese friends, yeah.
Didn't know that. Did not know that. Are any in the room now?
No.
No, okay.
Not
all
with
right,
Anne,
just
no.
checking. All right, so, Anne, you love this guy?
I mean, we've only been dating for a few months.
And, but you have reason to believe he's lying to you?
No, I don't.
No, I do.
Lying to me, I just think that I'm doing something stupid. I don't know.
Yeah, because he's not going to get divorced. He's got a wife.
Yeah.
All right. Well, there you go. Have you talked to him about this?
Yeah, he says he wants to get divorced, but he wants to help her get her green card first.
Well, where does he have any kids?
Yeah.
He does.
Yeah.
Do you have any kids?
Anne?
Did she just hang up or fall off?
What happened here?
All right, listen. I can't say that I'm disappointed.
All right.
Now I hope everyone just hangs up. Drew,
okay.
You just get the encyclopedia. We'll do the encyclopedia game. That's right. What we need to do tonight. We need to play the encyclopedia game. Somebody who's fast-fingered.
Oh, the dictionary game.
Oh, I'm sorry, the dictionary game, yes.
We try to look up words, who's the fastest?
Yeah, we don't have an encyclopedia here. That'd be that's a little pricey for Westwood One. I mean, there's more than one of those books. You got to have those whole volumes, right?
It's all available online now anyway.
Right. We want to play the dictionary game.
Right.
Drew looks up stuff in the dictionary. Drew, look up dictionary. Just look up dictionary, see how long that takes. Mm-hmm. And then just for kicks, look up irony.
Irony and dictionary.
Yes, yes.
I had to get my fingers into this a little bit.
All right. He's moving into the D's, ladies and gentlemen.
He's pretty slow right now.
I am.
Yeah, he's not moving too good. He's got that hernia going.
Hangover?
Yeah, he's hungover. He's got the hernia.
It is a reference book containing words.
Uh-huh.
How about that?
Does it say that you're reading right now?
No, it doesn't.
No, but that's what they should, just to freak out.
Alphabetically arranged, along with information, blah, blah, blah.
Look up definition.
Look up irony, and then...
we'll get speeded up here.
Yeah. All right. We're going to take ourselves a little break. I think we're going to have to play the dictionary game tonight.
Seems like I'm off my game. Here's Iron Hand, irony.
Yeah. What's irony say? Iron Maiden. What's irony say?
Irony, a pretense of ignorance and of willingness to learn from another, assumed in order to make the other's false conceptions conspicuous by adroit questioning.
Yeah, that doesn't get me any closer to comedy. Let's take a little break. Drew, look up break during the break. All right. And then look up sink while I urinate in the Westwood One sink here. Mm. When we come back, hopefully, we're just going to change gears in the show here. Right. I can't talk to effed up chicks who can't get it together. It's driving me nuts. I'm going to kill myself. I want some smart-ass 15-year-old whiz kid to call up and challenge Drew in the dictionary game.
All right.
All right. After this.
Loveline! Loveline will be right back, so get your problems ready. Ready.
Hey, everybody, it's Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Call in if you want to challenge Drew to a round of dictionary speed.
The dictionary game.
The dictionary game.
Yeah, my fingers are off, I think what it is. My motor skills off.
Yeah, Drew, warm up there on that dictionary. Yeah. Get your page there. Flipping on. Yeah, sometimes you gotta lick your finger a little. Just that's right. My move right before I go at my junk.
Yeah,
and just a little. It's like a gunslinger. No. It's not the spit and the rub. It's just taking the forefinger and dragging it across the tongue. It's a smooth move. You gotta learn that one. The chicks like it. All right, so we'd give three words.
Sure.
Best of three. And you gotta have a dictionary. You can't be on the computer.
Right.
And we'll take your word for it if you got it. We'll know. Ryan?
Yes.
You're 19?
Yes, uh-huh.
What's up?
Hey, I had a question. I was wondering if it's normal for a 19-year-old to not want to have sex.
No, that's not pretty normal. Male.
You?
Yes, I've had sex twice. Once was early Saturday morning, and ever since Saturday morning, I've been totally not wanting to do it ever again.
Yeah, that's been about 30 hours now, huh?
Yeah,
You had it your first time on Saturday?
No, I had a first time before, and I couldn't get aroused, and I it just didn't happen. This time
You're gay.
True.
No.
Please, true.
Well, that's one possibility. I mean, maybe you have just some...
Well, wait a second. Who'd you have sex with Saturday morning?
A friend of my ex-girlfriend. It was kind of like something that wanted to... that she wanted to do and do, and I said no because I didn't have a condom, and it ended up happening.
Right. Now, this is an ex-girlfriend who you hadn't had sex with before?
Yes, uh-huh.
That's a concept that doesn't compute for Adam.
And are you a religious person?
Yes, uh-huh.
You are.
Do you feel guilty about having sex?
Not so much guilty, just scared of maybe pregnancy or diseases. But yes, I do feel like I've committed adultery.
Adultery?
Yeah.
Was she married?
No. Well, I guess that's not adultery, is it?
No. I think it's just fornicating out of a wedlock. What what is your religion?
Just Christian.
All right.
Just belief in Christ.
All right. No, it's good times. Good times. And so you're not interested in sex. You had a couple of rocky experiences so far, and you have no girlfriend now.
No, no.
Okay.
Are you on medication?
No, I take an inhaler.
Do you masturbate?
I masturbate, yes.
Uh-huh. And you think about women when you do that?
Definitely.
How often does that do you do that?
A couple times a day, maybe.
A day?
Not.
Do you take the inhaler through the penis? Have you seen those, Drew?
No, that's a new one.
Oh, yeah, it's great.
Wow, so you're thinking about having sex, but when you actually do it, it's not so pleasant for you.
Yes, uh-huh. And after last night, I got so scared about pregnancy. We're going to go see... It happened early Saturday morning, and I got scared, and it was like, I felt like I was the girl, and she was the guy. She was like, don't worry, don't worry. But I called the
pharmacy?
No,
Planned Parenthood,
yes. Yeah.
Right.
And I asked them about the morning after pill, and I got freaked out because they couldn't do it on Saturday. They said we have to wait till tomorrow morning, so we're going to go down there. And that was another one of my questions is if that's too late, but...
No, that's fine. You have a 3-day window.
No.
The sooner the better, though.
Okay, well, listen. Ryan has some religious convictions that don't stop him from beating himself like a bongo a couple times a day. But
and it doesn't sound like it's the guilt so much as just the fear of pregnancy. Like,
yeah, and here's a guy who's scared of getting someone pregnant and scared of getting venereal diseases but doesn't use a condom in his last conquest. But here's the thing. He needs to not worry about it so much. He's going to find a girl. He's going to fall in love with this girl. And everything's going to be back and running again.
He does need to have a relationship. I totally agree with that. Also, I would worry that there's something biologically going on because in a natural male...
Well, true. I mean, a man of your great, great passion cannot sympathize at all with Ryan and his testes.
I can't comprehend it.
I think he's a little... There's some guys that are, you know, very guy-esque.
Yeah.
That's a great statement. But, I mean, they have a lot circulating testosterone. Yes, and there's other guys that are more... Like, put it this way. Doesn't every group of friends, if it gets males, 19, 20-year-old males, if there's one guy, there's a group of 6-7 guys, there's always one guy who doesn't seem that into it.
Yeah. But even so, he's preoccupied, and given the chance, let's put it this way. His fears of pregnancy and guilt and all that easily overwhelmed by his biology.
Right.
And so it makes me wonder whether his biology is toned down, like a prolactinoma or a thyroid or something. So he might want to get a medical evaluation.
He just needs to fall in love.
Yeah.
Anthony?
Yeah?
You're 15?
14.
14.
All right. 14's going to beat me here.
All right. You've been you a smart kid?
Yeah.
What grade are you in?
Eighth.
Eighth grade?
Yeah.
And what kind of student are you? A student?
I'm not. I just... One of the reasons I'm not is because I piss off my teachers too much.
I see. You're
smart.
You're diabolical.
Yeah.
You have a dictionary in front of you?
And my mind.
Your mind is a dictionary.
Might as well be.
Okay. Well, let's start then with the first word. That word would be pneumatic. Pneumatic. Go ahead, Anthony.
Let me think.
Drew's moving quite along. Now, Anthony, you're searching the Rolodex of your mind, looking for that definition?
Yeah. I'm tired right now.
Okay. I see. Okay. Drew, do you have pneumatic yet?
Move or worked by air pressure.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. All right. So Drew's got you on that one, Anthony. Okay. Although I must say you're at a disadvantage not actually possessing a dictionary for the dictionary game.
I'll go get one then.
Yeah, okay. Again, you know, rarely talk to the phone screeners more than once in the first hour, but in order to play the dictionary game, let's make sure they go ahead and have a dictionary with them. I know there's some confusion. Perhaps we would be providing them with a dictionary through,
airdrop,
ground transpo, but
the B-52s have been
they're busy.
Yeah,
they're busy. Yeah. So we'll try this again. And again, if you call in and you want to challenge Drew to the dictionary game, you must, and again, I repeat, you must have a dictionary. We'll take a quick break. Drew, maybe we should just play Muzak for the next hour. Even the dictionary game has not worked with our callers tonight. Okay, I'm going to yell at the phone screeners, and we'll be back.
All right, guys, here's the deal.
Dateline.
You're looking to hook up, sick of wasting time with the wrong person?
Dateline.
One call's all you need to make.
Call the Dateline. 877-889-DATE.
Call the Dateline.
Loveline, I'll be right back.
Hey, everybody, it's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191, but don't use that number to call this show. We are going to turn it around this hour, Drew.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah? You ready to rock, buddy?
I'm ready, dude.
All right.
Careful.
Do it!
You might be dropping trowel.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Maybe a little lightning round tonight, huh?
Haven't had one in a while.
Gotta. Well, it's important that the kids find out what the weather is out there. And then, of course, traffic conditions. Oh, yeah.
I heard one the other day. Driving out, let's bring this up with you. Dryer in far right lane.
There's an actual dryer.
Yes,
far
dryer.
Right. Interesting.
Nice.
Yeah, look out for brake lights, everybody. Gotta hear that traffic report every 8 goddamn minutes. Oh, I gotta straighten this city out, Drew. And the weather, please. Courtney?
Yeah?
You're 14?
Yeah.
What's up?
I'm writing a term paper on physical abuse and the effects on children, and I want to know if Dr. Drew had any information for me.
Yes. Look at a book called Traumatic Relationships and Serious Mental Disorders by a guy named John Allen.
Oh, she's not going down to
I'm just telling you, that's got a lot of really brings you up to date on the current thinking about trauma in childhood and its effects on brain development and later behavior and relationships.
Yeah, but she didn't call here to tell you to tell her to see some Squares
book. Basically, when a child is traumatized, two things happen. One is the child being threatened with the possibility of destruction and powerlessness at the hands of somebody that they rely on for safety is so overwhelming that the brain kicks into a mechanism where, in order to deny that possibility, the child takes a position that they caused this to happen. They're still in control now because, after all, it's because of them being so bad that they caused this adult to attack them in this way.
Well, we do hear lots of adults that we talk to say, well, yeah, my parents gave me a whooping, but I brought it on.
Right.
I acted out.
Right. The reality is that children do not cause parents to lose their ass, that the parents are just out of control.
Your parents never hit you, huh?
And want to hurt the kid. And the other consequence is the child loses the capacity, or very quickly loses the capacity, or trauma survivors we see lose the capacity to explore the minds of their caretakers. They deny the contents of people's minds. It's too scary to start looking into other people's minds because in there is the possibility of finding somebody who wants to destroy them. And so they turn from the developmental strategy of using other people's minds to determine and develop a sense of self and regulation of self to more primitive auto-regulatory strategies.
Drew, do me a quick favor. Yeah. Use the dictionary. Look up boring. Yeah. Boring.
Now listen.
Hey, it's
Listen. Boring. Here's my picture.
Boring.
It's a big
glossy picture of Dr.
Wow.
Drew.
Thank you, Adam, for making me
look
this up.
Yeah, it's a little surprise for you.
Thank you so much.
All right, really, really read boring and see if you're defined there. Courtney.
Wait, real quick. Tara just asked if Drew's face was really in the dictionary. She was 100% serious.
Oh, poor Tara. Don't call me Tara.
Boring is causing boredom.
In a way, I'm envious of Tara and her.
It would have been nice to go through life like that.
Yeah.
The state of being bored. So now let's look up bored.
Yeah.
Bore. Uh-huh. To
what?
Kind of pierce with a twist.
It's ironic that you're boring people with your definition of boring. Is your very definition of boring is more boring than you are, Drew?
One that causes boredom. Damn it. And boredom is one who is boring.
So All right. Hey, Courtney.
Yeah.
What grade are you in?
Eighth
grade. Yeah. And you're doing a term paper?
Yeah.
How many pages does it need to be?
8 to 10.
8 to 10?
Yes.
Holy Christ, it's a Magna Carta. I couldn't fill up that many pages when I was in the eighth grade if I just put one letter on each page and ended up spelling the word aardvark.
Okay, well, don't get mad at me, but I didn't get the title of the book.
Oh.
Traumatic Relationships and Serious Mental Disorders.
So, Courtney, you do everything on the computer now, right?
Sometimes.
You get on the internet, find whatever information you need for paper, and then type it up?
Not really.
No. Is everything typed?
For the final draft, yeah.
Is everything typed now, Drew? Well, your kids do a paper. Is it all typed?
They write stuff. No, I wonder why they make such a big deal about learning cursive and all this stuff.
Right.
But ultimately, yeah, they do type a lot of stuff, and they learn typing as quickly as they learn writing. Oh. I found a board.
Good, here we go.
Something that is devoid of interest.
Yeah.
See also D. Pinsky. Yes.
That's right. And then you'll find the picture that Tara spoke of. Laura?
Yeah?
You're 15?
Yep.
You write a challenge, Drew, in the dictionary game?
Yep.
Well, hold.
I have a dictionary.
You do?
Of course.
Hit it. Do me a favor.
Yeah?
Hit it against your head so we can hear it.
All right.
All right.
I didn't hit it against my head. I hit it against the phone, but...
No, no. Against your head. Against your head.
All right.
All right.
You hear it?
Barely. Drew, I'm trying to kill a few precious brain cells before we actually go to work. There's Drew hitting his head with the dictionary. All right, Laura, you ready to go to work?
Of course.
Now, wait a second, Drew.
Yeah?
We just looked up something in the dictionary, so I'm thinking maybe we take one call and then we get back to the dictionary
game.
All right,
okay.
All right?
Why not?
What's that?
How about we just do it now?
How about we just do it now?
Yeah.
Let's see. Drew, look up bitch, would you please? All right, quiet down. We'll do it when I'm good and ready. Hang on. We take one call. Jesus Christ, these smart kids.
Mm.
You know, the first part of smart ass is smart.
Yeah. Yeah, you're halfway there just being smart.
That's right. Just hang on there, Laura. We'll take one call, and then we'll get to you in the dictionary game. John?
Hi.
You're 16?
Yeah.
What's up?
Well, see, my girlfriend and I, we've been going about 5 months, and, you know, I want to, like, give her oral and... You know, she feels like she's ready, but there's something about the idea that's kind of uncomfortable for her. And I was just wondering if you guys have any ideas on, like, how to make her feel a little more comfortable.
Yeah.
Just wondering what his expectation is of us.
You want her to feel more comfortable receiving oral
from
you?
Let him do it, yes.
Yeah.
But it's not her performing it on you.
No.
It's you on her.
Right.
Has she ever done it to you?
No.
How does she feel about that?
She would be more comfortable doing that than otherwise, but not very comfortable.
You know what? She's not ready for the whole thing.
Yeah.
This is not the right time for her. How old is she?
16, same as me.
Yeah, she's not ready yet.
Okay.
Don't push things too hard.
You guys been together for how long?
5 months, roughly.
5 months. And, John, you're a virgin?
Maybe.
Yeah, I can hear it. I can hear it in your voice, buddy. That's cool. What's wrong with that? You got a girl.
He's deflated. Oh.
You got a steady squeeze.
Oh, damn. I thought I pulled. Oh, I thought
what are you guys doing? What are you guys doing now? Just making out, feeling up the sweater, that kind of stuff.
Second base.
Second base.
Second base.
Second. Although every time he says second, it sounds like he's saying sucking.
Second.
Second base.
I think it's more of a sort of a rounding first is what he's really saying.
What have you seen Bear Boob yet, John?
Oh yeah.
You have.
Mm-hmm.
On the internet or on her?
On her.
Interesting.
Yeah.
All right, John.
Sucked on it.
You sucked on a bare breast?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That must have fogged those big glasses up.
No glasses.
All right, context. So, John.
Yeah.
Yeah, just take it slow. You got a good thing going here.
Okay.
Then you guys start feeling more comfortable.
Okay.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
All right.
Take the pressure off yourself.
Okay.
All right, and good times. Good times. All right.
I got to perform.
Laura?
I'm sorry, Adam.
All right. That's all right. We're going to look up a series of three words.
One at a time, though. It's best of three.
One at a time.
We have to read you the definition.
When you have the definition, you must shout your name, and then you must come up with the definition immediately after you shout your name.
Right.
If I hear any page flipping after you shout your name, I'll know you're cheating.
Okay.
All right. Now, Drew.
Mm-hmm.
I need you to take the dictionary,
mm-hmm.
and you just set it down. Right side up, please. And you just take both hands and put them up my ass. All right.
Ooh,
very good.
Mm-hmm.
Please take the medical ring off.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So both hands on the console there, Drew. Laura?
Yep.
I need you to set the dictionary down.
Yep.
All right. Is it set down?
Yep.
Where are both your hands?
On the dictionary.
Okay. Take them off the dictionary.
All right.
I'll set them next to the dictionary. No contact with the dictionary. Watch it, Drew. All right. You ready?
He reaches over and shoos my hand off the...
Trying to think of the first word. The first word is computer. Mm. Computer. Yes, go.
A device that computes, especially a programmable electronic machine that performs high-speed mathematical or logical operations, or that assembles, stores, or correlates, or otherwise processes information.
Oh, lucky guess.
Yeah.
Could anyone get bored working with a fascinating computer like you?
All right, so, Drew, you're 0 for 1, buddy. Laura, that's just the way you do it. You yell your name out and then the definition.
Okay.
All right?
Yep.
All right, we're going to move down.
Formidable opponent.
We're going to move down the dictionary. Or maybe not. I don't want to give away too much. Laura, you're not touching the dictionary?
Not anymore.
All right. The word is reconcile. Reconcile. I'm pretty sure Virtual Adam could handle this, too.
Think so?
Yeah.
Okay.
I got it, too.
Go, Laura.
To establish a close relationship between, to settle or resolve.
She got
it. Oh, boy.
She got me. I got my finger on it, though.
Drew, go ahead.
Oh. To restore or to friendship or harmony.
Uh-huh. Day late and a dollar short.
Let's look up sweep.
But just, yes.
Swept.
Just for the sake of entertaining myself, let's try one more. Although Laura's clearly taken the best two out of three
competition.
How does
she do so quick with that dictionary? I
don't understand even. She has little fingers, and they're able to manipulate the dictionary very quickly. Also, she probably has a Pro Series dictionary, whereas Drew just has a crappy, bad 60s Westwood One.
And what
style.
Would a Pro Series dictionary be?
I don't know. I haven't worked that out yet. I'm guessing the pages are treated with Teflon. It's probably an easy flip cover, that sort of thing.
No, it's pretty old, just regular Webster's.
Regular Webster's. And bang it on your head one more time so we know it's there.
All right. There you go.
That sounded like the desk.
No, that was. I hit on my head, then it fell back on the desk.
Okay, good girl. All right. Now, I'm trying to think if I should come up with an easy word or a tough word. It wouldn't be fair, though, for me to pick one that she didn't know how to spell.
No, it's okay. Try me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
All right. I'm trying.
I may not know how to spell it either.
Well, I don't. If you two don't know how to spell it, I certainly don't know how to spell it.
Yeah, but you're not the one looking it up.
All right. Let's say hydrogenated. Drew's moving with a certain vengeance now.
Yeah.
Go.
To combine.
I'm on the right page, but I can't do it that fast.
Subject to the action of hydrogen, especially to combine an unsaturated oil with hydrogen to produce a solid fat.
No.
That's a bad
definition.
That's
off the top of her head, Drew.
I just got to add hydrogen to the molecule.
Laura, you are the champ, my friend.
Yay. And that one I got too fast, too.
Yeah,
right? I
mean, Drew was moving.
She was still faster.
Wow, Laura. You're sharp, my dear. Congratulations. You in high school?
Yeah.
Just 10th grade?
Ninth grade.
And taking Drew to school.
Hmm.
Wow. Yeah, how you doing with the fellas?
Okay.
All right. Looks and fast dictionary finger.
Can I ask Drew a question?
Mm-hmm.
If somebody, like, let's say there's some girl, or I guess she's anorexic, does that mean necessarily that they have a controlling parent?
It does not mean that necessarily. Trauma survivors also commonly get eating disorders.
Okay, and
but
what about, like...
But a common sort of classic parent of an eating disorder patient would be an intrusive mom. A mom who just doesn't identify the child's separate needs and is intruding with her own needs upon the child, and it can come across as controlling.
What about two parents where, like, one is more lenient than the other, so that one is always kind of trying to, in front of the kid, they're kind of debating, like, oh, no, you're being too soft, oh, well, you're being too...
Wait, is this your parents?
No way.
All right, well, then forget it.
It's hard to know what you're describing, but it's somewhere in there was some trauma, I suspect.
Wow. Speaking of trauma, what about the trauma Drew suffered at the hands of
There's
ninth
no way.
Grade
Think
Laura?
Think about it. Put another one out there. There's no way I could keep up with that. I mean, that hydrogen, I got too fast.
Yeah,
I
know.
And she was...
She's nimble, this one. Didn't sound Asian, either.
Ask.
No way. Laura?
Yeah?
What's your nationality?
Caucasian.
Yep. See that? See who says we don't come smart once in a while? Drew always putting down women.
Oh, yes, we do.
All right, baby doll.
Thank
well, we'll see you in the Supreme Court one day.
No, I think... Okay, yeah.
All right. Fantastic. Let's talk to Ashley, who's 17. Ashley?
Hi.
What's up?
Okay. Every time I go for a pap test, they cannot find my cervix.
They never find it? Or it's never been found?
No, it has not.
Is there a problem getting the speculum in? Do they have to use a small speculum?
Well, yeah, they get the smallest one, and...
Well, that makes it difficult already.
Really?
Okay, but see, I've tried different sizes. Uh-huh. I think they try two different sizes, and they could get it in, but all they do is poke me, and they can never find the cervix.
All they can do is poke you?
Yeah, because they're, like, looking for it, and it hurts. But, I mean, they're like, oh, we can't find it. Come back next time.
True. Speculum is that duckbill device.
Right,
that basically is a spreader, right?
No, it's open like a duckbill.
Well, it spreads. It goes in, and then you spread it.
Yeah, okay.
Right?
Yeah, I think that's spread being sort of lateral spread, but it's up-down spread.
Oh, it's up-down?
Yeah.
Well, it's not lateral.
Uh-uh.
They put the thing in.
And then it opens like a duck bill, literally.
Yeah, but I thought they would put it in sideways and spread out that way. It seems to be the direction it's going.
No. Let me show you.
Huh.
Getting the picture out here. Hold on 1 second, buddy.
Seemed tough to feed in. Did they put it in sideways and then turn it?
No. It's got a lip on it. So you put it in and you catch the cervix.
Yeah.
You catch this side with the longer lip and this side with the other, and you open it and this flips down.
Yeah.
So now you're looking straight at the cervix.
More great radio from Dr. Drew. Showing me the big anatomy.
But you see what I'm saying? It hits.
Yeah, but I'm saying, how do they get it in there? They got to put it in sideways and then turn it. It's like putting
it's flat. It's pretty flat. It just goes right in. Slips right in.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it like putting a shoehorn into your shoe sideways?
No.
No?
It fits. I understand what you're thinking, but it's not that wide.
All right. So anyway, never.
Their problem is with her. They're not using a big enough speculum. They can't get that in. And then it's probably a retroverted uterus, so they can't clip it and flip it over.
Right.
It's flipping way back.
Yeah.
Okay, because I'm due in 2 months. So
you're due in 2 months?
Yeah, I'm going back in 2 months to try again, they said.
And this is a gynecologist, or what kind of doctor are you seeing?
It's
a heating and air guy, Drew.
It's a what?
It's
not a gynecologist.
It wasn't a gynecologist. It was someone at the clinic. So
all right. You need to see a gynecologist.
Okay.
That was like a nurse practitioner or something. You need to see somebody who's used to really doing an exam.
Yeah. Let's talk to Jenny, who's 18. Jenny?
Yeah.
What's up?
Okay. You know how guys always say that their penis is going to cut off, you know, and they're just going to commit suicide?
What?
Their penis is going to be cut off. If their penis is going to be cut off, then they're going to commit suicide.
Guys always say that? Adam, you always say that.
Anyone who knows me knows.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's the way it's going right now, because I just had a kid. I've been with this guy for 4 years. And my kid is 3 months, and now I can't orgasm, and I could before. So I'm, like, really freaked out, and I've already been stressed, you know, everything's building up, and then this is just adding to the top, you know, and I'm like, okay, what do I do, you know?
Did you continue to have sex?
By the way, hold on a second. Feel free to call the show and state your problem, but don't start with a retarded hypothetical that no one understands.
Yeah.
It takes the first part of your question to explain.
You know how guys always talk about it? They want to kill themselves?
I couldn't even hear what she was saying.
I still don't quite know what that was all about.
What? All right, she feels like she wants to kill herself, too, because her penis was cut off. But, Jenny.
Yeah.
You've lost your... All right, you've lost your sex drive.
Okay.
Is that true?
Yeah, it's because before, like, we used to go for, like, seriously, like, 10 hours, you know, and I'd get a whole lot of orgasms. And
now you have to raise a kid. You can't just sit around and have sex all
the time.
Well, of course, but...
Believe me.
Look.
Well, I'm on the patch.
All right.
Good. Can turn your radio down, screwball.
Okay.
All right.
Well, I'm going to talk to her again.
I know, but we want a whole nation of tards raising kids?
We got that. That's what we have.
We got to move. I'm trying to think where. Mexico or Canada? Let me think.
The beaches are better in Mexico.
Yeah, but... Jenny?
Yeah.
All right.
So, were you on the birth control pill ever in the past or any other form of hormonal contraception?
No.
So, this is maybe a reaction to that. It can also be a reaction to the pregnancy. Very often for that first year after delivery, women have a marked drive in their sex drive. You also could be depressed, get a postpartum depression, and that can drop off your sex drive and affect your orgasmic functioning. So, there's a lot of things can be going on here. You need to go talk to your obstetrician about it. It's very common.
Yeah, do you think she has an obstetrician?
Somebody delivered that baby.
Well, that's just a county. Jenny?
Yeah.
Do you have a doctor?
Yeah.
You do?
Uh-huh.
Why is that so tentative?
I don't know what that means. Because...
Drew, look up tentative for Jenny.
I don't know the definition of that word.
Oh, okay. Well, meaning...
Why do you sound so unsure of our asking about the doctor?
Well, if she doesn't know, then I'm going to be pretty much left with nothing, you know? I mean...
All right. Well, first of all...
I know it's not postnatal depression because I only went to that for like a week and that's already passed.
All right. Well, you know. And what about... Are you married?
No.
Where's the guy?
In a boys' home now, but he got a home pass. I hope he's not listening.
He's what?
He's in a boys' home.
Boys' home.
Yeah, Phoenix house.
But he got a pass.
Yeah.
So he can use the bathroom. How does that work?
So he can use his. Well, he's at his mother's house. He gets a home pass.
But, Drew, let me ask you this. He got a pass to go home. Jenny, how old is your child?
3 months.
3 months. Can't you give the kid up for adoption? Give it a fighting chance?
Too late now.
I'm a good mother.
Oh, yeah.
I'm actually very intelligent.
Oh, I know. Sharp's a whip.
Yeah.
Tentative. Okay. So Jenny, is this guy, who are you planning on having sex with?
Him,
because he's got a pass now.
Because he's my baby's daddy, and I love him, and...
Yeah, no, and he's getting in trouble with the law, right?
Well, yeah, but the thing is, like, he doesn't have a father, and to him that was really important.
Having a father.
Yeah.
Yet magically he's going to create the same thing for his child, no father.
All right. Possibly, or he could become a better one.
Yeah.
Has anybody... Right, that's true.
That's one of those are the two possibilities.
That's right. Or there's a third, which is he could replace the Sultan of Brunei as the richest man in the world.
Yeah.
Jenny.
Yeah.
How are you supporting your child and yourself?
Well, I had money saved up for a car, so...
I see.
And that money, sometimes my mom buys diapers and such.
Oh, okay. And had some car money saved
up. Yeah, baby, raising a child is about the equivalent of purchasing a cheap car.
I've said it many times. My parents spent upwards of $400 on me and my sister combined. Jenny?
Yeah?
No more kids, though, right?
No.
No?
No.
Okay, no more.
All right, here's the deal. So listen to me. It could be the normal changes of having had a pregnancy, or it could be the patch you're on. In either case, you need to talk with the doctor about it because there are things they can do to help you. It's still possible that you're depressed, even though you don't really specifically feel sad. There are other things that can be part of postpartum depression.
Let me ask you this. I don't know why it reminded me of this, but I was thinking of the whole pass with the bathroom and the kid. What's going on in this country that every goddamn bathroom outside of your own house needs to be locked up? Like, yeah. I go to the dentist office. The guy's in a high-rise in Beverly Hills. In Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
I mean, he's right on Wilshire, right in the heart of Beverly Hills. I got to take a leak, so I come into the guy's on the fourth floor. No, there's the men's room. I'll just take a leak here. Oh, no, door's locked up. You want to take a leak, you got to go in and get the blue toothbrush. That's the male, the pink toothbrush. And you got to walk around like a retarded kid. Hey, you go to a gas station, although none of the a-hole gas stations in this Los Angeles County actually let you use their bathroom. But back when you could, you'd have to drag like a car rim with a key on it or a paddle with a key on it. Can't we be trusted to take a leak? What's going on? Like, what happens? Is there going to be a steady stream of folks going up to the fourth floor of the Beverly Hills, a high-rise building, the commercial building, so they can...
With a tagging pen?
So they can just spread fecal matter all over themselves and then stab and rape somebody as they come in. Like, can't we just go ahead and head in and take a leak?
And by the way, these buildings already have security guards at the front you're signing in with and calling upstairs and stuff, right?
Every commercial building, you want to take a leak, you got to go get the keychain from the dentist or from whoever is in that building. What the F? What is that? Is this more lawyers? Mm-hmm. Like, what are you going to, sue? Like if I just go upstairs and see the men's room and go, I'm going to take a leak, and I open the thing and I slip. Is it, I get the building now? I slipped on some bum urine? Jesus Christ. What's going on? What is happening in this god-awful country of ours that man cannot take a leak anymore? It's become too dangerous to, is it from a legal standpoint, to leave bathroom doors open? What the hell is going on?
Yeah, it's strange.
Yeah, why, everyone bring it up to whoever they need to bring it up to. I'm always the a-hole because I'm bringing it up to the dentist. Why can't you leave the goddamn door open so I can take a leak without asking for your permission? And it turns you into a jackass because you're like, especially if you got to double down. Had a couple cups of coffee, you take a leak on the way in, and then you're stepping out. It's been an hour and a half later, you realize you got to go again. It's like, yeah, I'm going to need that big novelty-sized molar with the key on. Yeah, I got to take... Oh, again. Yes. I'll be taking a leak again. Like, I have to announce this to everybody, and then you make it... Well, I'm just washing my hands. I'm not going to go. Number one. Certainly not number two. The hell is this? All right. We'll get into this more when we come back.
LoveLine, LoveLine. We'll be right back.
LoveLine is brought to you by Trojan, America's number one condom, the most trusted for over 80 years.
It's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. I was watching 2020 on Fridays. I normally do when I'm at home, and they're doing a whole thing on the Iraqi war, and they interviewed some. It was an interesting story. It was Barbara Walters interviewed five Iraqi students or young people who were over here who were there during the Gulf War in 1991. And they're all young at the time, 8, 9, 10, and then they fled over here because they didn't know what the hell was going on over there. And they interviewed them, and all of them were happy that we were going over there trying to get Saddam out of power. And they had some different messages to send home if their people, family members, stuff like that were watching this and all that kind of stuff. And they would look into the camera and say, like, you know, be strong and God willing and this will all be over and Saddam will get out of there and blah, blah, blah. And she asked them a whole bunch of different questions, and they were glad the United States was trying to get over there and get this tyrant out of office. But in all the five people and all the comments, a half-hour interview, not one hey, thanks for the effort to the United States.
Yeah.
And I don't know what it is with this world that thinks that's so taboo, but I'd like a little thanks. I'd like a little thanks for the, you know, $100 billion it costs, and the when you look into the camera, how about a little message to the parents who've lost their child trying to liberate your beloved Iraq, or how about the widows that are now home, the young children, the people who've given their lives over there, the United States people who go over there, realize it's wrong what's going on, and sacrifice, and sometimes make the supreme and ultimate sacrifice with their lives over there. How about a little thanks? That's all I want to hear. That's all.
I think it's because the U.S. government put Saddam in power, though. That's their problem.
Yeah, we didn't put him in power. Please. Guy's been in there for 30 years now. And according to everybody, whenever there's a war, somehow we put everybody in power. And also, there's a lesser of evils. I mean, we all know what went on during World War II. You know, we allied with the Soviet Union. They were a lesser evil than Nazi Germany and Italy was, and Japan was at that time.
Right.
Then later on, they emerged as evil, and then we dealt with them. I mean, that's the way it goes. It's like you get into a prison riot, you may have to take up with the Crips, the Bloods, or the White Aryans, whatever it's going to take to win the battle. And then start looking around at who's doing what after that. Mm. What should we have done? Told Mother Russia to F herself in 1942? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
Have the Axis powers just take over the world? No. You got to do what you got to do. That's what we're doing now. I'm just saying, from the rest of the world, and especially the good Iraqi people that are here and see what we're doing is a good thing, just how about a little tip of the hat? Have a little thanks for the effort.
I'm amazed at how similar this all is to the Spanish-American War. I went back into some of my history books, and even to the extent that Britain supported us in that war, our only ally in that one.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. Very, very interesting.
Well, history repeats itself. And so does Drew, because he's going to say this again tomorrow.
Tomorrow night, yeah.
Jeremy?
Well, maybe again tonight, even.
No, not tonight.
Jeremy?
Yeah, hi, how you guys doing tonight?
You're good. You're 28.
Yes, I wish I had... good news for you to follow that piece, but the dictionary game.
Mm-hmm.
I was loving it so much, and I was rooting for Drew every time. But I had a feeling in the back of my mind that technology was about to be obsolete, and so here's what I did. I had my computer in front of me, and I used a website, a dictionary website, at the same time. And the answers that I got back for the words that Adam gave out were exactly the same as the words that the girl gave out.
Oh,
that makes. I was. I don't see how she could have done it without that.
I mean, I was hauling ass on those.
You well, know? You, the first couple you weren't so fast on, but
hydrogenated. I was hydrogenated.
No, that's greased lightning on that one. Interesting. Yeah. So you got on your computer dictionary the exact same definition down to the word.
It's but it's a website. It's dictionary.com.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's I don't know who's behind it, but I use it all the time, and I I cried when I got the same answers that she got. So
yeah, this is why the terrorists hate us, Drew, because of this type of foul play.
I thought the bright side that I could spend to this was that Adam improves your theory that all colors are in fact dumb.
Well, let's see. Now you have it. Why don't you bring it up in front of you right now and let's just test the technology.
We'll be glad to.
Oh, and Anderson has it himself there, so we can have a little freeway. Three-way. Drew.
Oh, I want to use a word?
Yeah. I'm going to give a word out. Now, we couldn't hear her typing. I don't know what that meant.
Couldn't hear her flipping either, though.
That's
well, typing is my... I mean, I got a laptop keyboard. You probably won't hear the typing.
Yeah.
Interesting. So interesting.
It's like, what's coming back to me is, what was that book about the strong Henry or something who would make tunnels, and then the machine came along to make tunnels, and...
Yeah. John Henry, the steel driving man?
I think that's the one. This is horrible.
There's a few stories where someone has to race a giant ox and a lumberjack and Paul
Mike Mulligan
Bunyan.
And Marianne, yeah.
Yeah, and the guy has to tunnel through a mountain, and he's a steel driving man.
But
it's also a Subway commercial.
When she was getting those, I couldn't understand. I was thinking to myself, well, just younger hands.
Well,
more agile.
let's more agile mind.
No, because I was reading pretty fast.
Now, and also, what about when you put the spelling into the dictionary.com? Does it have to be the exact spelling?
No, it'll give you a second choice.
Well, it's dictionary.com.
No, it will. I use dictionary.com too. It will give you. Do you mean blah 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 blah? And then you click on that.
All right.
Google is better at that. You can actually get to dictionary.com through Google.
All right.
Google will give you better suggestions.
What a shock that Jeremy's calling from Palo Alto, California. All right, are you ready?
Am I ready?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah, get ready. Here's the word. Concubine. Concubine.
This also depends on the speed of the connection, but got it. Concubine.
All right, go ahead.
I'm on the page now. Same
go
thing
ahead.
As last time.
Ready?
Yeah.
One law. A woman who cohabits with a man without being legally married to him. Two, in certain societies, such as Imperial China, a woman contracted to a man as a secondary wife.
You know what's interesting? It's, again, the very, very long involved, and I got mistress.
Right.
You know, they're very different definitions than what I get in the...
That cheating witch.
A woman living in a socially recognized state of concubinage.
And we didn't hear him typing either, did we?
No.
Interesting. Well, Jeremy, thank you. Drew's...
Pleasure.
Drew has been restored to a full man now. Drew, that was tough getting your ass kicked by a ninth grader.
It was frightening.
And listen, all you a-holes out there. And I know. I was in ninth grade once. I was 28. but this is the thing. Like, when they do that thing where, like, you go trick-or-treating as a kid and someone takes a big plastic pumpkin and fills it full of Mars bars and says, take one, please, just one, and you walk off with the whole pumpkin, or at least you empty the pumpkin into your pillow sack and then take a dump into the pumpkin and walk away. I know how it is. It's hard to go on the honor system when honor is lost in this society.
Yeah.
But just for the sake of
fun.
Sport. There's no money going to change hands here. We're trying to play the dictionary game. You have to get the dictionary out. All right. Well, turns out our little Einstein was cheating, but if she's listening and wants to call and explain herself, I'll be willing to entertain that. Lizelle?
Yes, this is Liesel.
Liesel.
Yes.
Liesel.
You're 32?
On a hill, a lonely girl.
32, yes, indeed.
Don't know. This is from The Sound of Music?
Yes.
Is that the Sound of Music name?
No way that the name came up other than the parents naming her after the child in The Sound of Music.
Really? All right. And you're 32, and you feel much less sensation during sex recently.
Yes.
That was also a topic in the movie, wasn't
it? Yes,
yes.
It was a song about that, yeah.
All right, hold on a second. What's that damn plant they had in there?
Edelweiss.
Could have been. She probably got a brother named Edelweiss. All right, we'll take a little break. We'll be back with Liesel after this.
Loveline. 1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
Hey, everybody. Loveline. Yeah. All American Rejects. Yeah, I like this song. That's a little better than Ezra in it. Yeah, I miss that better than Ezra, by the way. Yeah, remember those guys? Mm-hmm. Yeah, good guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah? I do, yeah.
See them make a little comeback.
Yeah. Them and the Psychedelic Furs, huh?
What was I saying? Liesl?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, 32, yeah. And you feel much less sensation during sex recently.
Recently, in the past, say, 6 to 8 months.
Mm-hmm. And we established your name came from The Sound of Music.
I'm not exactly sure what their deal was.
Okay.
But
all right.
Never checked into that, huh?
I checked into it. I've gotten a couple different answers from the family, so not sure which one's the actual.
What are the other answers?
My mom had a friend named Liesl.
Who was named after the
movie. Who was named after The Sound of Music.
Okay. All right, well.
Close enough.
Close enough, exactly.
Are you on any medication?
No, I'm not.
Anything going on in the relationship?
Maybe they were trying to name her Easel and her parents are Asian.
Or French. Liesl.
No, but they would say Easel.
No, but Liesl. Liesl.
All right, true. Touché.
Yeah. So, anything going on in the relationship right now?
Actually, I moved from where I was with him, and he's still back there. He's still in Connecticut. So, it had been about it's been about a month and a half, but it was going on for like 8 months before that, 6 to 8 months maybe. Lot less sensation, and I'm wondering if it's just my age, what I can do about it, that sort of thing.
Are you getting menopausal symptoms, anything of that sort?
No. My periods come regularly and all that good stuff.
And no other medication, nothing else going on medically with you?
Allegra, off and on, for allergies, that's it.
Allegra D or just Allegra?
Just regular Allegra.
All right. You know, I would tend to look at the relationship and see what's going on there. Because it really, if you really are not, your body tells you things, particularly women, when the emotional component of the relationship is sort of not where it needs to be.
Guys do, too. It tells them they're hungry or it's time to beat off.
Yeah.
Those are the main messages body says.
Anything going on?
I've been with him off and on for 5 years, and certainly we've had our ups and downs, but I don't think it's the emotional side. I think it's more physical on my part.
Do you feel like something biological is going on with you?
Yes.
Have you been checked out recently?
I went for like an annual about 6 months ago, and everything was fine.
But how do you know something physically is going on, especially with women?
It's hard to tell, but listen.
Internally. Internally, it's just the feeling is not there as much as it used to be. And like I'm saying, I don't know if it's my age, if I can do some certain exercises, or...
Have you had a child?
Nope. Mm-mm.
And
no,
is
no.
This a long-distance relationship?
Well, it's ended since I moved away. I mean, we're talking on the phone, but we're open to seeing other people and so forth. We're not keeping it together. We were together off and on for 5 years.
Yeah, I think you need to find a guy who's going to rock your world.
Yeah, I'd
love to.
Yeah, I think I really have a sense that if somebody came along that you're really into, this would change a little bit. I really do. And if not, then you really need to go have a complete medical evaluation. And sometimes perimenopausal symptoms can come on. You're awfully young for that, but it's possible. And it can certainly change how you experience yourself sexually or other medical conditions as well.
Brent?
Yes.
You're 24. Hey, what's up? Good.
I had a question about, I was reading about smart recovery as opposed to AA.
You mean rational recovery?
Yeah, there's smart recovery.
Are you on the speakerphone?
No, I'm on my cell phone.
All right. Continue.
I'm an OxyContin addict. I've been clean for about 31 days.
Yeah, well, just stay with traditional 12-step right now. Don't. You're not in a position to be making decisions. Let's put it this way. In terms of what's considered standard of care, in other words, by your insurance company and by the state review agencies, basic 12-step for an opiate addict would be considered standard of
care.
What's
smart recovery?
These are other variations on 12-step themes. Really, when people do rational recovery or smart recovery well, they end up doing the same thing as a traditional recovery program. And stick with what is known, the best thing that's available, that has the highest probability of being effective. And really, for OxyContin addict, you need to be in a very structured, preferably residential kind of model for many months.
Well, what is smart? Like, I guess the beef that a lot of people have with the 12-step program is that it seems to be religious.
Precisely.
And so smart recovery would be sort of the atheist.
Attempts to get that piece out of it. But it's a misconception. Really, all that higher power stuff is really ultimately just an attempt to either just give people the sense of security and faith that things will work out, that they can be powerless over these things, their disease. And if they need be, a relationship with some idealized other, if that's important to them. But really, the real thing here is just to feel secure and have faith that letting go and experiencing the powerlessness won't destroy them.
Yeah, but don't you have to do this in all facets of life? You know, I mean, when the president is giving a speech and he's saying, God willing.
You have to use your own interpretation.
Yes. Yeah. The Lord will seek divine mercy on it. And you have to just, you know, you're constantly doing that as a semi-atheist or at least a thinking man in this society, right? Just sort of pull God out, put nature in, or spirituality in, or whatever it is.
And then nowhere more than in recovery is where you've got to make it your own. It's there to help you go through the process, that's all.
All right. I can't talk about it. I can't take another coos call, Drew.
Come on.
Find me a big jug call.
We don't got one.
And by the way, I announced to the phone screeners a good year ago, I wanted some big jug calls back on the air, and we've gotten two in the last 40 months. Let's talk to Lauren, who's 15. Lauren?
Hi.
What's up?
I'm going out with this guy, and he's 2 years older than me.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been going out for now 2 weeks, a little over 2 weeks, and we've had sex. But the other night he was over, and we were with a couple of friends, and they were in the other room. And we were about to, like, just, we weren't going to have sex, but we were just going to, just, we were kissing, and it was going to get more serious. And he said, bring your friend into it, or bring my friend. And he's like, bring her into it. I want her to double team with me. And I just
got very sweet guy, very
perfectly reasonable request,
very nice, compassionate, just a regular guy.
Yeah, and so he kept on, and I just kept saying no because I didn't think that was right. And
Lauren, this guy's a dick. Get rid of him. I swear to God, you will rue the day you stay with a guy like this.
The thing is, like,
Drew, look up Rue
and God.
Right.
He took my virginity, so it's kind of hard. Like, it's more.
It is difficult, but you made a mistake thinking this guy's gonna be around for a long time.
The thing is, like, and then a week after.
Will you listen? If you've been listening to the show for a while, we opened in the first hour. We made the sort of statement that the way people should approach relationships is cut your losses. All relationships that aren't working, cut your losses. Don't go, well, he took my virginity, I got to make it work. No, realize what's going on here and cut your losses.
Okay.
Can you do that?
Yeah,
Don't get caught up in this, he took your virginity BS. He's an a-hole.
Okay.
Any extra hour spent with this man is a wasted hour.
And it sounds like dangerous to you. Dangerous to your emotional health, physical health.
He doesn't love you the way you love him. And that's unfortunate, but that's all right. Okay. It happens to everybody.
Well, not everybody, but you learn.
It doesn't.
Happens to a lot of people.
Well, everybody has a little unrequited love in their day, right?
That isn't reciprocated. That's very common.
And I just kind of like, I just said, then would you care if we brought like your friend into it? And he's just like, no, I would feel uncomfortable. And
yeah, whatever. The point is, it's all about him. He doesn't care what you want anyway.
Yeah, and in 2 weeks in a relationship, this guy's
balls.
Bucking for a threesome?
It's ridiculous.
You tell him.
With a 15-year-old, he's 17, you gotta call him, you gotta tell your parents.
Well, she's not going to do that.
Yeah, but that would really...
Just break up with the guy. Just listen to us.
Okay.
Drew's a genius.
And so is Adam.
And so am I. I only said that so Drew would say, so is Adam.
But he got terribly, terribly high last night.
Yeah. What are you going to do, Drew? There's a lot of peer pressure going in those Hollywood parties.
I noticed that.
I didn't want to get stoned, but, you know, they hand that little bong to you.
Was it a bong?
It was a miniature bong.
And why did you have to run to the bathroom to do it? They're at their own house.
I didn't run. Since when is galloping running?
Okay, you skipped.
All right.
Here we go.
We'll take a little break. We'll be back.
All right, guys. Bottom line, here's the deal. Looking to hook up?
Sick of wasting time with the wrong person? One call's all you need to make. Call the Dateline.
877-889-DATE.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Well, that's the show, everybody. I'm gonna brush this show off like, you know, in baseball, guy has a bad game, goes 0-4.
Yeah.
maybe hits into fielder's choice or something like that, first fourth time at bat. Made a little contact, but still goes down in the scorebook as an out. That's tonight's show's going to be. That's all right.
Just get to the next game.
Yeah. Barry Bonds, McGuire, they'd all go 0-for-4 on occasion.
Oh, yeah.
They come back and hit a couple dingers the next night. Though. Mm-hmm. That's what a champion is. And that's what you're going to see in the Corolla Kid tomorrow night. Oh, yes. Coming back with a vengeance.
Yeah, whatever.
Better juice up a bit.
Something to prove. Yeah, I'll get on that creatine.
Yeah.
And come back with a vengeance tomorrow night. Liam Lynch will be in here tomorrow night. We'll talk to him and talk to you. And until next time, this is Adam Kroller for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
You hear this show. People go through these kinds of traumas all the time.
I want to be like the people at the show.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station.
The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.